the days grow short when you reach September. Hasn't got time for the waiting game, and the days dwindle down to a precious few. These golden days I'll spend with you. Thank you.
I'm Denise Nelson Nash. I am Vice President and Secretary of the Board of Scripps College. And more importantly, I am a graduate of the college and one of the many students who was inspired by and motivated by Samela, even though she always reminded me that I never took one of her classes. So today it is my honor to greet all of you and to also bring greetings from our president, Amy Marcus Newhall, who is observing Rosh Hashanah. She wanted to be here but couldn't be, but I am delighted to be here in her stead and also to bring her spirit with me. So in 1974, there was an article in the Scripps College Bulletin titled Getting to Know Samela Lewis, in which the article ends with the following exchange. Interviewer, Samela, if you were to choose one thing to be known for, artist, art historian, author, teacher, or whatever, what would you choose? Samela replied, a person. The interviewer asked, being a person is the most important thing to you? Samela confirmed, that's right. Samela was indeed a person of impact, a visionary, a boundary breaker, and a person with unwavering purpose. Samela was the first tenured Black faculty member at Scripps College. She taught at Scripps from 1970 to 1984. Now you know how old I am. That's her student. And was the recipient of the 1984 Faculty Recognition Award. Among the courses she taught back then were Explorations in Media, the Black Experience, Art, Media, in Relation to the Black Experience, The Art of Black Cultures in the Americas, Seminar in the Contemporary Art of Asia, Africa, and Latin America. This exemplifies Samela's dedication to pushing Scripps and its students to explore, question, and learn about non-Western cultures during a time of the 1970s post-civil rights gains, and the 1980s political undoings. So in fact, in that same interview I mentioned at the beginning of my remarks, Samela emphasized the importance of Scripps students and their role in her growth. She said, students contribute so much to my motivations and challenge me. They give me ideas that I never thought of before, especially Scripps students. Because we don't have massive classes, we can talk with each other. I found that Scripps students have a lot of questions about non-Western culture, and they're very receptive, yet they have their own ideas about things. So I need other minds to feed into and help me to continue to develop. Well, Samela helped me and countless others to develop. Her brilliant legacy continues to shine upon us. And while I never took one of Samela's classes, she served as my professor in leading a life filled with curiosity, tenacity, purpose, and service. And to hopefully, one day, I will be able to look back and claim that I lived a life as well as Samela. So now it is my pleasure to introduce Mary McNaughton, another alum of Scripps and former director of the Ruth Chandler Williamson Gallery, to share her reflections.
Thank you, Denise, very much. I'd like to add my thanks to Jeremy Taylor and Jenny Young for an unforgettable rendition of September Song. That will stay with me for a very long time. Well, the world lost a bright light when Samela passed. For many people, Dr. Lewis illuminated Black art and brought attention to artists who had long been ignored. So today, it's a joy to celebrate her full life and rich legacy in the arts. And for organizing today's wonderful event, I'd like to thank Aaron Curtis, who's the new director of the Ruth Chandler Williamson Gallery, Kirk Dillman, who is the former interim director, who has really brought so much of this event together with a stunning exhibition, which you'll see afterwards. And then, of course, Claude Lewis, who has made everything so special each time with Samela, bringing her to campus for many events, and getting to know him well. It's been a real honor and privilege for me. So Dr. Lewis was extraordinary for the many ways she left her mark. As a gifted artist, pioneering art historian and author, beloved teacher, as Denise said, an activist and advocate for Black artists. Carolina Miranda of the Los Angeles Times called her the godmother of Black art who helped preserve its history. When I was a student at Scripps, I just missed the chance to study with Samela because she retired just before I began teaching here. And then I just couldn't be in a class of hers, even though I wanted to, because I realized that she had left campus. So I heard about her from a distance. So it was really a wonderful opportunity for me to get to know her when I was director of the Williamson Gallery from 1993 to 2021. And for many summers, I took interns to visit her at her house. We would see Samela and Claude. They were so generous with their time. She showed our interns her art studio and talked about her inspiration for her paintings and prints. And she also discussed the extraordinary works of art that were all around her in her collection that was in her home. And that was really extraordinary for us. We were looking at works by Romare Bearden, Elizabeth Catlett, Jacob Lawrence. Samela also enjoyed getting to know our students, and we often had lunch at one of her favorite restaurants, one of her favorite Ethiopian restaurants, where she shared stories of her life, which revealed the warmth and strength of her character, which I think you can feel just looking at her image. Well, Scripps has honored Samela's contributions as an artist and teacher at Scripps with a scholarship in her name. And in 2007, I collaborated with alumna artist Allison Saar and professor of art Susan Rankitis. And together we founded, in Dr. Lewis's honor, the Samela Lewis Collection of Contemporary Art at Scripps. And this collection, which focuses on art by women and Black artists, has really become a rich resource for teaching. Many students have the special experience of learning directly from works of art and have the opportunity to help organize exhibitions at the Clark Humanities Museum and the Williamson Gallery. Samela was so generous with her time, and we are grateful to her and to Claude for laying the foundation for the Samela Lewis Collection with gifts of works by leading Black artists, such as Elizabeth Catlett, Faith Ringgold, Carrie Mae Weems. And then later, through the Scripps Collector Circle, we were able to add more works from her collection by other major figures, Romare Bearden and Jacob Lawrence. And I'm grateful to the co-chair of the Scripps Collector Circle, Professor Emeritus of French and Humanities, Dr. Eric Haskell, who's here with us today, who is also the director of the Clark Humanities Museum after Samela retired, for convening. He was a brilliant master of ceremonies and convened 5 gatherings of the Scripps Collector Circle, which really added substantially to our teaching collection. Well, we are most grateful to Allison Saar, who has helped build the collection in significant ways with gifts of her prints and sculptures, including the wonderful Swing Low, which I'm sure many of you have seen, bronze sculpture of Harriet Tubman, which is located just outside the Williamson Gallery. It's a smaller version of her monumental work by the same title, which is located on 121st Street in Harlem. And alumna, trustee, and former board chair Lynn Thompson, who will speak today, wrote a beautiful poem inspired by this sculpture. which she recited at the 2010 dedication of the sculpture, which was held on Harriet Tubman's birthday. And this evening, we'll be able to see more Samela Lewis Collection works in the current exhibition organized by the fantastic Kirk Delman and the gallery staff to honor Samela. The exhibition title, Getting It Done, really fits Samela, who, when she saw a need in the arts, worked diligently to fill it. She was determined, persistent, and successful in achieving her goals. And looking back, we just wonder, how did she accomplish so much? Well, Samela was an unstoppable creative force. As she said, "I have the idea that you can do what you want to do as long as you are really serious about it." I think we see that in her face as well. But we wonder what motivated her. Well, she explained, "My inspiration as an artist and art historian comes from the need to bring attention to accomplishments of African American artists." And that she certainly did. I'd like to look back in her life and just point to some of those accomplishments. As an artist, she focused on what she knew, African American experience, which she visualized in paintings and prints. And she learned this approach from her mentor, Elizabeth Catlett, who guided her at Dillard, historically a Black university, and later at Hampton Institute of Virginia. Like Catlett, Samela focused on African American subjects and became both an artist and an educator. Thanks to Catlett, she also discovered the graphic power of woodcuts. And we'll see that in Samela's images, particularly Field, which was on the cover of the what's on your announcement. Well, early on, Samela had an abiding interest in both art and history. And it's not surprising that she received the first PhD from Ohio State University in the combined fields of art history and studio art. There she focused on African, African American, and Native American art, all subjects that she would later teach. So we see that dual degree really set the stage for her later academic career. She became a professor, associate professor at Morgan State College in Baltimore, then chair of the Fine Arts Department at Florida A&M, and later at State University of New York at Plattsburgh she taught, before moving to Los Angeles with her husband, mathematician Paul Lewis, and their sons, Alan and Claude. Well, Samela was a teacher and a scholar with wide-ranging interests. She was fascinated by art history, anthropology, and language. In 1962, she won a Fulbright Fellowship to Taiwan and studied Chinese language and art, followed by a postdoctoral fellowship at USC. And then in 1970, she began teaching here at Scripps, where she had a huge impact. Dr. Lewis extended the art history offerings beyond European and American art, as Denise had said, to include courses on African, Black art, and Caribbean art. And she was the first Black tenured professor at Scripps. Her belief in art was that art is not a luxury, as many people think. It's a necessity. And it documents history, it helps educate people, and it stores knowledge for generations to come. Samela enriched students' education by bringing celebrated figures in art and literature to Scripps, to campus, including Maya Angelou, Elizabeth Catlett, and Alice Walker. In addition, she mentored talented students who became leaders in the arts. Among these was the late Polly Nutter Roberts, who we all miss so much. She was professor at UCLA and consulting curator of African art at LACMA. And Polly said, "Samela's example as a humane scholar and practicing artist has had a lifelong impact on my own mission to teach and curate exhibitions about the richness of African arts and culture." And of course, another distinguished alumna is internationally known artist Alison Saar, who's with us today. and who thrived with Sonella's encouragement to study non-Western art, and Allison will tell us about what Sonella meant to her. But as an art historian in the late 60s, Sonella saw a need for serious writing about African-American art, which was not available in existing books or journals. So she created pioneering scholarship in this important area. Dr. Lewis set a high bar with her two-volume compilation of artist interviews, co-edited with Ruth Waddy, entitled Black Artists on Art, so valuable for scholars who have followed her and for artists who were interviewed. And when she ran into indifferent art book editors, she created Contemporary Crafts, her own publishing house, to produce the book. Other publishers took note, and in 1976, Harcourt Brace Jovanovich asked her to write a survey of African American art, which was the first college level textbook of its kind. And when Sonella realized that few art journals covered Black artists, she created Black Art, an international quarterly, later known as International Review of African American Art, now housed at Hampton University. And this journal was crucial in establishing a publication record for many African American artists. When she saw the paucity of monographs on leading Black artists, in retirement, she wrote two substantial studies, one in her mentor, painter, printmaker, sculptor Elizabeth Catlett, and the second on the extraordinary sculptor Richmond Barthé. Both books greatly enriched understanding of their art. And when she saw Black artists being passed over by galleries, she co-founded one called The Gallery and was active in two others which focused on Black art. And Sonella and her good friend, artist Betty Saar, together pursued their own creative visions and nurtured a supportive artistic community. In 1976, Sonella also helped found Los Angeles's first Museum of African American Art, which is still here and now part of the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Mall. Sonella helped advance the careers of so many artists. At Scripps, as director of the Clark Humanities Museum, she organized exhibitions of major artists, including John Outerbridge, Noah Purifoy, Betty Saar, and Howard Smith. In addition, if that wasn't enough, she also made documentary films on sculptors Richmond Barthé, Bernie Casey, and Outerbridge. As she wrote, "The artist is an interpreter, a voice that makes intelligible the deepest, most meaningful aspirations of the people." Sonella also fought for representation of Black artists within museums, and in the late 60s, in the education department at LACMA, she formed an activist group, Concerned Citizens for Black Art. In addition, she advocated for civil rights and fought racism. While working at Florida A&M, she was active with the NAACP, and at SUNY Plattsburgh, she also founded a chapter of the NAACP. Well, thankfully, in her later years, Sonella received richly deserved recognition. Bringing renewed attention to her art were two important exhibitions in 2012. Louis Stern Fine Arts Gallery in Los Angeles presented a solo show, Sonella Lewis and the African American Experience, with a catalog essay by art writer and alumna Suzanne Muchnick. And this was part of the Getty's reassessment of the importance of West Coast art, a huge project that was called Pacific Standard Time, that kind of rebalanced the focus between East Coast and West Coast in terms of the contemporary art scene. Also that year was another key exhibition at the Hammer Museum, Now Dig This, Art and Black Los Angeles, 1960 to 1980. Which showed how Sonella had been integral to the mid-century Black art movement. Subsequently, Sonella's works were featured in major exhibitions at the Brooklyn Museum and LACMA. Well, Dr. Lewis also received professional recognition with major awards in 1995 from the College Art Association and the UNICEF Award for for visual arts. And in 1996 and 97, the Getty recognized her as a distinguished scholar. She also received honorary doctorates from Hampton University, University of Cincinnati, Dillard University, her alma mater, and California College of the Arts. Now, Samela's paintings are in many collections, not only at Scripps, but also at the Philadelphia Museum, the Metropolitan Museum, and the Museum of Modern Art in New York. As an artist, art historian, curator, editor, filmmaker, and activist, Samela played a fundamental role in establishing the importance of Black art, both past and present. And she and Betty Saar definitely helped build the Black art community in Los Angeles. And we are grateful, so grateful to both of them. Many have recognized the compelling power of Samela's expressive imagery. And now we certainly miss her. But we can still feel her presence in the artworks that grace the Scripps collection. And the memory of her wise smile stays with us. Thank you. Now I'd like to introduce Samela's son, Claude Lewis, who studied at Pitzer College, Xavier University, and California College of Arts and Crafts. He's the owner of Unity Works in Los Angeles, a talented musician and composer of reggae music. Claude took very good care of his mother, Samela, and now manages the Paul and Samela Lewis estate. Claude?
First of all, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out to honor my mom. There are so many people here who played a part in establishing her legacy. Can't mention all the names, but you know who you are. And all of you in your own way, even by being here, are still contributing to that legacy. And as a family, we would like to thank all of you. It's fitting that this event is taking place here because Scripps was her favorite stop in a long journey as an educator. The friendships that were established here were friendships that would last for the rest of her life. Many thanks to Scripps for establishing the Samela Lewis Collection and the Samela Lewis Scholarship so that future generations will know her and know what she stood for. Thank you, Mary McNaughton, for all the birthday parties long after she had retired, well into her old age. Thank you for making her feel appreciated and for appreciating what she had to offer as an educator, as an artist, and as a friend. Me and her would also like to thank you and Sperry for sending all those bottles of guava jelly, homemade guava jelly, delicious. And as you can probably tell, I was addicted to it. I'm just going to say a few words about growing up as the child of Samela Lewis. I feel blessed to have had the parents that I had. Both my mom and dad were brilliant and progressive people. I want to give a shout out to my dad, who usually gets left out of the discussion, but he was brilliant in his own right, and he was always there to support her and was a major part of most of her endeavors. I would consider them to be a power couple long before that term was one example, and I was too young to appreciate it at the time, and Mary touched on it. When we first moved to Plattsburgh, New York, we were the only Black family in the whole city. Yet they started a branch of the NAACP. to this day, it blows my mind. It was just them and the liberal whites. But that was one of their strengths, the ability to galvanize and work with people from all different backgrounds. And they were actually my earliest inspiration for independent Black business, which at the time was a very revolutionary concept. Then we moved to LA, and quick story on why we moved to LA. When I was in the third grade, I had a little playmate across the street that I used to play with. And one day I went out there and he was explaining that he had asked his grandmother, who he lived with, why I was a different color than everyone else. And she told him it was because I was a Negro. So when he told me that, you know, I wasn't familiar with the terminology, so I took offense and immediately kicked his ass. And when I went home, I asked my mom, I said, do we know any Negroes? And she told me later that she knew then that that was the time to move. So, and interesting, my brother, who's 4 years older, he told me the reason we left Florida, because they were active in the civil rights movement. She told him that she had to get us out of there because she didn't want us to grow up hating white people. So I thought that was pretty deep too. After that we moved to LA. She was studying Chinese language at USC, and it seemed like that's where things really started to take off. The books, the galleries, the museums. In my opinion, LA was where she was really able to express herself as an artist, scholar, and activist. And she knew so many people, like actors, politicians, artists, people from all walks of life, and regular people, eccentric, some of them, important, some of them, but people of every background and type. And she cared about all of them. And as a child, I took all of this for granted. It was just regular life to me. Even as an adult, the full realization of her impact is still reaching me. Most of you know her story, so I won't get into all that. But one thing that I'm really happy about is the recognition that she got later in life. People loved and adored her because they knew that her works were not selfish works. They were created to bring enlightenment and understanding. Two things happened when she was well into her 90s that really impressed me. Her second to last exhibition was in Detroit in 2016. The outpouring of love from the people was incredible. When she was signing autographs at the opening, I heard a woman much younger than her tell her, "Meeting you is like meeting Prince." So that really impressed me. And also, the line for her autograph was so long that one guy had to leave. He couldn't wait, so he asked me to sign. The second thing that happened late in her life, and I was so glad that she was still alive to witness it. Most of you probably know how when she worked at the Los Angeles County Museum in the 60s, she organized a protest in a picket line to picket the museum for not having enough works by African-American artists. So fast forward to just a few years before she passed, LACMA actually purchased one of her paintings. And while I know LACMA today is different from LACMA back then, it's still a great full circle story. And it's indicative of the progress that she worked so hard for. So that's all I'm going to say. I want to thank everybody, and I really appreciate all of you. Because like I said, all of you are here.
creatures of the wind.
to begin by thanking Claude, Kirk, Mary, and all those here at Scripps for giving us the opportunity to celebrate Samoa and her extraordinary life. Last time I saw Samoa was at an exhibition of my daughter Maddie's work. I looked across the room, and there she was, engaged in what she has always done best, supporting and uplifting fellow artists. This moment held profound significance for me because it marked the third generation of artists in my family she has graciously supported. Back in the 1970s, Samoa had been one of the first curators to grant my mother Betty Starr a solo exhibition. Later, when I was graduating from high school, it was Samoa who encouraged my parents to have me apply to Scripps. Undoubtedly, it was Samoa who used her gentle, yet persuasive influence to ensure that Scripps accepted me, a fair to middling student with little or no sense of who and what she wanted to be. This opportunity proved to be pivotal in my career, primarily because it granted me access to Samoa's incredible wisdom and grace. I am certain that many here share similar stories, whether they were artists whose work were showcased in her galleries that she managed, or the Museum of African American Art, which she founded, or aspiring art historians who learned from her that African art was a living and thriving tradition, or that African American artists had a rich legacy largely overlooked by the mainstream. It was Samoa who first introduced me to the extraordinary work of visionary self-taught Black artists such as David Butler, Nellie Mae Rowe, and William Edmondson. She was also a staunch advocate of artists from Mexico, the Caribbean, South and Central America, and Asia. Samoa was a true revolutionary. Wearing many hats as a curator, director, journalist, author, professor, mentor, activist, historian, and artist, but she was also a trickster. For beneath her petite frame and soft voice, sly smile, and wry humor lay an undeniable fierceness. While some may have patted themselves on their back for achieving two diversity points in one single hire, a twofer, Samoa being both Black and female, little did they know that she would then insist on further diversification among faculty, staff, students, and curriculum. As a guardian of the crossroads, she forcibly busted down the gates of the ivory tower, clearing the path of greater equity and justice. Finally, I would like to touch upon Samoa's artistry. For although she spent much of her life promoting the work of others, perhaps her greatest gift to us was her own work. Working in many mediums, she initially portrayed friends and family in rural Louisiana through stark and expressive woodcuts. Some depicted weary field workers after long days of labor, while others radiated defiance. She later turned her gaze towards the civil rights movement, capturing harsh realities of police brutality and segregation. In the closing chapter of her life, Samoa had the privilege of focusing almost exclusively on her own work. Each day, she would take the short stroll from her studio to her home, behind her home, allowing her work to flow freely between figurative and abstract painting. With vibrant colors swirling like gathering storms, her art spoke of both external and internal landscapes. In Samoa's passing, we have lost a luminary, a trailblazer, and a true advocate for the arts and social justice. Her legacy will continue to inspire generations to come, reminding us all of the power of creativity, the importance of inclusivity, and the indomitable spirit of a woman who dared to challenge the status quo. Ashe. Ashe. So now it's a great pleasure to invite up to the podium a colleague and a dear friend, former Poet Laureate of Los Angeles, Lynn Thompson.
It's such a delight to be here this afternoon with all of you. Thanks so much to Claude and Kirk and everyone who made this happen and who invited me to be part of it. I'm not going to rehash all you've heard today, but I can add one thing. I was a junior when Samoa Lewis showed up on the Scripps campus. You've already heard that she was the first African-American faculty member. And Claude used the word galvanized. And I will tell you, she turned us out. Scripps was never the same. Whether you were in her class or not, she was an inspiration. She showed you what was possible, gave you the opportunity to follow your dream. I can tell you, when I came to Scripps College, my parents were not planning on me being a poet. I think my mother's words were something like, oh, Jesus. But Samela taught us, whether in the classroom or out, as I said, the important contributions and legacy, and she is now part of that legacy, always in our minds, always in our hearts. And I wanted to share a poem with you that I thought kind of spoke to that. The poem begins with an epigraph by the scholar and philosopher W.E.B. Du Bois. Would America have been America without her Negro people? Once we were rivers, but is this the last of us? Gone the mean barracoon, gone the deep, wide rivers of us. No more roosters or pickled pig feet, no Aretha or respect. Is this the last of us? Our African less African and gone, our tap less Bojangles, Hines and gone. Gone the deep, wide rivers of us and gone too our faith and fidelity to the Betsy Ross stitch. And Martin, was he the last of us? And Malcolm, Harriet, Barbara Jordan, all gone. Who remains to pray for the deep, wide rivers of us? Gone our song and its shadow, gone the tongue of the gullah, gone the deep, wide rivers of us. Is this the last of us? You can't really believe that. You've been seeing the last of us for a long time come. Come first the black women and their people, Amina of Zaria, Anna D'Souza in Zinga, Nandi. Then come the transatlantic traders sailing from Luanda, Malembo, Sierra Leone, landing Grenada, St. Vincent, St. Kitts, landing the Carolinas, Virginia, New York. Come then the black men running, running, too many slave names like my great-great-great-grandfather George, Fred Douglass. This is not too old a story. See Emmett Till, Harry Moore, four dead girls in an Alabama church. Some say only a few bad rogues, but today's cops, just like yesterday's patty rollers, shot Stephon Clark, shot Danny Ray Thomas, shot Antoine Rose II, shot Deontay Yarber. All of them unarmed. And all of this in the same year of who's Lord? So we fight. We fight for the last of us, even fight each other. Ali Boumier. But then we hear the kora, the talking drum, the balafon and marimba. And Josephine Baker heard them, and Jacob Lawrence heard them, and Toni Morrison heard them, and Jesse Owens running heard the drums, that turned the Arthur Ashe racket into a drum, the diplomacy of Ralph Bunch into a drum, the demand of Ida B. Wells into a drum, like Prophet, thanks to Samela Lewis, was a drum, like Basquiat's obnoxious liberals was a drum, like Harriet Powers quilting was a drum, like a LeBron James dunk is a drum, and didn't Father Curry preach in the Church of England, like a drum those lords and ladies had never heard before. So they know, as you know, there will never be a last of us. See the Jessies of Tennessee. We come like rivers. welcome back Jeremy and Jenny.
I do want to say one last thing, because I see that Crystal Jones is here, and many times it's been mentioned about the Simela Lewis Scholarship. Well, you know, these things just don't happen. It was myself, Crystal Jones, who's here, and Sedalia Garrett, who's not here, who urged and cajoled and made sure that we got our fellow graduates to contribute to create the scholarship. And I'm happy to report it's worth $500,000 today. The student that receives it gets $20,000, and you know, that's substantial. So, and you can contribute. Okay, I'll just say that.
My point is,
that is the type of love and inspiration that we all had as a result of Simela. Like I said, I never took her class. I was a performing artist, I was a dancer. And she encouraged me just by being here. And she kept her eye on me. She knew what I was doing. So again, I want to thank you all for being here. And before we walk over, I just want to say one more time, to Claude and to Kirk. They put so much into making this day happen, and it was a true labor of love, and for many others in this room too that contributed. But I just wanted to say thank you to the two of them, and Claude and I were around at the same time, so you know, a lot of connections here. I'm supposed to give you directions now. So we're going, as we exit the building and you're out on 10th Street, which is the entrance you came in, we're gonna turn to the left, and there will be some guides for us, some of our wonderful students who will help us over to the gallery. Do you want to exit now so you can be ahead of the group? Thank you, okay. And we'll go over to the exhibit and we're gonna get it done together, okay? All right, thank you all.
You.